And we welcome you to Journey into Faith, brought to you every week by The Bible Speaks in Laconia, New Hampshire, USA. It's so great to have you watching us across the world, that you might experience the same blessing we're experiencing from Almighty God. Tonight I'll be preaching the second message on this subject, Jesus is coming back. Stay tuned. Right now we begin our service with a song that is going to be sung by Bob Eli, and it's a great song entitled All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. Yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
We'll crown him Lord of all. Thank you, Bob. What a song. What a wonderful reality that we can actually give praise to Jesus Christ and exalt his name and crown him Lord of all. For he is that. Right now, we're going to have a song by Eugenia Clark, and it's a very important song. It's entitled, Somebody's Praying.
Somebody's praying, I can feel it. Somebody's praying for me. Mighty hands are guiding me. You protect me from what I can't see, 'cause Lord, I believe. Somebody's praying for me. Angels are watching. I've been through the darkest caverns where no light had ever shone. Still I pushed on, 'cause there was someone who was down on their knees. Lord, I thank you for those people praying all the time for me. Somebody's praying, I can feel it. Somebody's praying for me. Lord, your mighty hands, they're guiding me. They protect me from what I can't see, 'cause Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Somebody's praying. Somebody's praying for me. And I thank those people who through all these years have prayed for me and have brought me to where I am with my walk with Jesus Christ.
And may that be a reminder to keep praying for her and all your brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm going to read from the scriptures tonight. I'm going to read starting in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 50 through 53. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. And 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. And John 14, 1 through 3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for these words. They certainly are comforting. As Pastor Horn comes forward to preach this message, Jesus is coming back. Give us all an understanding of the fact that Jesus is coming back. Help us to understand it even better than we do now. And just bless each person that hears this message. And bless you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Bob. You may be seated. People ask the question, when is Jesus coming back? We're not told to speculate about it or to try to pick a date or, like some, to go up on a mountain and wait. We are told to occupy till he comes. But this message is concerning the signs of the times. We are experiencing the signs of the times like never before. The book of Revelation is becoming a reality right before our eyes. There are five reasons I want to give you to begin this message with that Jesus Christ must return. He will return in the rapture, but this is talking basically about him coming the second time to the earth. He must come to the earth and set up a kingdom. And there are five reasons why that, at least five reasons, why that is a reality. Now understand, before this takes place, what Jesus describes through Paul in the book of 1 Thessalonians is a reality. Jesus catches up those before the tribulation that are saved, have received Christ as their Savior, so that they are not appointed unto the anger and the tribulation of God. They will be caught up in the clouds. A totally different event than him coming down to the earth and setting up his kingdom is the rapture of the church of Jesus Christ. Now, first of all, of these five reasons that Christ has to return after he has caught us up and there's been a seven-year period of celebration and a wedding feast in heaven while a tribulation is going on this earth, he'll come back with us, the saints of God, and these are the five reasons why he must come back and set up a kingdom. First, Jesus must come back because of the promises of the Old Testament that have yet to be fulfilled. Every promise of God concerning his first coming as a baby was fulfilled. Every one of them. There is not one of them that is in the Word of God in the Old Testament about his first coming that hasn't been fulfilled. Therefore, everything he predicted would happen before he comes the second time also must be fulfilled. And these have not been fulfilled as yet. In Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7, it gives one of these things that has not been fulfilled that will be fulfilled because God keeps his promise. What does it say there? The government shall be upon his shoulders, not upon some politician's shoulders, not upon some world leader, but on the shoulders of Jesus Christ. It goes on to say, and of the increase of his government, Jesus' government, and peace there shall be no end. It's an eternal government. It goes on to say in that passage, upon the throne of David, so it's going to be from Israel, and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice henceforth forevermore. That has not taken place. It has to take place because Jesus would be a liar. The word of God that was given to Isaiah would be a lie if it didn't take place. It will take place. This scripture, therefore, has not been fulfilled. World peace has not been brought. Jesus Christ has not ruled yet. And the Bible says when he does rule, he will rule with a rod of iron. It will not be a choice. It will be a mandate from Almighty God. He will bring it the second time he comes upon this earth. In Micah 4, verse 3, it says these words, at that time when he establishes his government on this earth, they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall there be war anymore. We know that hasn't been fulfilled. There are wars all over the place now and rumors of other wars. Mankind has lifted up his sword against each other. But when Jesus comes to rule, it will not take place. He will rule as God Almighty. Consider the wars that are being fought now and consider the peace that will come one day under God's rule, not man's. So that's the first prophecy that has to be fulfilled if God is telling the truth, if Isaiah has heard from God, and if the reality of Jesus' rule takes place. Second, Jesus Christ has to return because of his own statements. If Jesus Christ does not fulfill what he said he would fulfill, that has not yet been fulfilled, he's a false Christ, and he is not a false Christ. The word of God says, "For as the lightning comes out of the east and shineth unto the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be." This prophecy has not yet been fulfilled, but I believe it will, because he said in John 14, verses 2 to 3 that Bob read, these words, "I go." Jesus was on this earth. He was talking to his disciples, and he said to them, "I go to prepare a place for you." And then he made this statement, "And if I go," and I'm going to go, "to prepare a place for you, I will come again." Either Jesus Christ was a lunatic or he was telling me what's going to happen in the future. It will happen because Jesus never lied. He says, "I will come back for you, and I'm preparing a place for you, and I will receive you unto myself, that where I am and he ascended into heaven, there you may be also." My Jesus tells the truth. That prophecy has not yet been fulfilled, but it will be fulfilled. And it's getting nearer and nearer and nearer, even at the doors. He gives us a new life there in heaven, according to the word of God, and he has a great plan for our eternal future. One will not be bored in heaven. You can't even imagine, he says, the things that he has prepared for them that love him. Heaven is truly going to be heaven, and that's all I can say about it. And somebody has said it's too wonderful for words, so God didn't pen them down. The Bible says we're going to be one day experiencing becoming a joint heir with Christ, and we'll spend eternity with him. Jesus said that, therefore it has to take place if he is who he said he was, God Almighty. Third, Jesus Christ must come back because of the present position of Satan. Remember, he is the small g god of this world. You see him ordering nations. You see him ordering politicians. You see him giving direction to the common individual that has no understanding of Jesus Christ. You see Satan at work today, and it's like never before. It's as the days of Noah. Jesus Christ has to come back to get rid of Satan and deal with Satan. That means that Satan right now is the director of false religions. All religions are false. Christianity is not a religion. It's a personal encounter with God Almighty. It's not a true religion at all. It is a God encounter religion is trying to reach for God, but Christianity is God reaching down to man. It is truth, and it is being hindered by Satan in this day in which we live. Humanity is helpless before Satan unless they have the armor of God on and they have the power of God in their life. They're committed to Jesus Christ. But one day, Jesus is going to cast Satan into the bottomless pit, and after a season, he'll let him free for a moment, but then he will cast him into the lake of fire, which is eternal damnation, alive in hell, but not fellowshipping with the others that'll be there. He must come back. Jesus must come back if he's going to deal with Satan. Fourth, Jesus Christ must return because of the present chaos in the world. This world is racked by pain, suffering, hunger, murder, lust, greed, hate, fraud, and corruption. It is a horrible world that Satan has taken over, and it is man's choice to let it happen. But it is a horrible world. God's going to establish a new world, a new order, a new earth, a new heaven. The scriptures say in Isaiah 35, verse 4, these words, "Say to them that are of a fearful heart because of what's going on in these last days, be strong and fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance against Satan and against ungodliness, even God with recompense. He will come and he will deliver you." In the midst of this trial that we're going through of Satan taking over, I can tell you this, Jesus has a rescue plan, and it's called the rapture. Fifth, Jesus must come back because of the dead in Christ. Those who have died in God to heaven, but they're not in their resurrection bodies yet. When Jesus comes back, there will be, according to the word of God, a great resurrection, and the believers will be raised from the dead, and the believers that are alive today, according to 1 Thessalonians, will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Now, what are we looking for in this world? Those are the promises of Jesus. But what are we looking for as we see the end approaching? Well, Jesus said there would be intellectual and mental confusion and disturbances throughout the world. People are trying to see psychiatrists all the time, but the psychiatrists are looking for psychiatrists themselves. The word of God says in Luke 21, verse 25, "In these last days there will be upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity." The word distress means tossed from all sides, and perplexity means no way out. If you knew what our presidents really know about what's going on in this world, what China's planning, what North Korea's planning, and all the other countries of the world that hate godliness and are persecuting Christians, if you knew what they were planning, your heart would fail you for fear unless you trusted Jesus. And that's what many of our presidents have said in the past, and it's got worse and worse and worse. But God is still in control. And it says in 1 Timothy 4:1, "In the latter times, in the last days, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." People are going to churches today that teach the doctrines of devils. They don't teach the word of God. They teach everything but the word of God. And that, my friends, is a sign that Jesus is about to come back. There will be lawlessness all over the place. We see that in our streets today. What are we to do? Very quickly, as our time is fleeting, first we are to purify ourselves according to 1 John 3:3. We're to live godly lives. Second, we're to watch. Be aware he's coming very soon and prepare for it as if we knew it was coming today. The word watch means that we are to desire his coming. Third, we are to work. We are to serve God with all of our hearts, knowing that the time is short. And the last one, four, we are to be prepared. Are you prepared for Jesus to come? Are you prepared for that shout from heaven, come up here? And all of a sudden you're in the presence of Almighty God, and all that you wished you could done on earth either has been done or not done. The time is short. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can come to you and we can rely upon you. As the world goes crazy, we don't have to go crazy. We can receive your word and believe your word and look up, for our redemption draweth nigh. Friends, if you've never received Christ, ask him to save you right now. Come into your life, forgive your sins, and save your soul. Don't worry about anything else, anyone's thoughts about what you're doing. Just receive Christ before it's too late, and you will be blessed by Almighty God. God bless you as you journey into faith.